Recorded Books and RB Digital present Mutiny at Vesta by R.E. Stearns, narrated by Mia Barron. Chapter 1. Time integrated through digital intermediary, 1 hour 53 minutes. Adda Karpe disconnected her mind from the ship around her and sat beside Iridian Nassir on the surface currently serving as a floor. The ghostly intermediary figure connecting Adda and the ship's AI vanished. Iridian wrapped her golden brown arm around Adda's waist without interrupting her story. "So, I thought, Pell's dying around here somewhere, and what do I need two kidneys for anyway?" and grabbed the bastard. "This is what I got for it." Iridian raised one side of her shirt to her armpit. A tapered line of recently regrown flesh marred a tattoo of a flap of skin pulled up to reveal a skull and crossed rib bones drawn over realistic viscera beneath it. The other people in the Casey Meyer-Meyer's main cabin, a man just out of his teens with the same pale complexion as Adda's, and a darker man with a beard like a stylized leaf, laughed and swore respectively. "Wish I could see it," the younger one, Pell, said. Goggles with dark blue lenses hid his scarred eyes, reflecting the ceiling wall seam lights from where he sat on the floor near Adda. The Casey's bedroom door slid up and open. Captain Sloane crossed the main cabin to the bridge console in two low-gravity strides, long coat and neatly braided black hair following after. "We'll be in range of Vesta's southern docking guides in 5 minutes. Are all of you ready?"
"Finally," Pell said. "The Casey is so slow."
"Hey, it's about average." Iridian glanced around, brows furrowed, like audibly insulting the ship was a bad idea. Perhaps it was. "We got here as fast as any ship could, without attracting the ITA's attention anyway."
Sloane's lieutenant, who shaped his beard like a stylized leaf and went by Tritheist as a name, stepped around Adda's mesh bag of drone parts to stand beside the captain.
"The news feeds still run daily Barbary Station updates. Vestin Dock security will be expecting us. The ITA won't, or if they are, the local bureaucrats will keep them from stopping us."
"Good." The captain smiled, a flash of white teeth against dark skin. "Welcome home, lads and lasses." Sloane turned to Adda and Iridian. "The ship does intend to dock here, I assume." The captain's smile looked more forced now.
"The Casey's letting us off here, yeah."
Iridian cast a suspicious look at a cam in a corner of the main cabin, which served as one of the Casey's many eyes. Adda and the Casey had discussed their destination after the Casey had docked with a fuel barge on the Mars Series reliable route and decided to stay there for 2 days after it finished refueling. It had picked its own time to leave for Vesta, too, despite all of Adda's arguments to depart sooner. The delay had given Captain Sloane time to straighten out crew finances and pay for the fuel, but Iridian and Tritheist had taken shifts intimidating the barge crew into allowing them to stay. Without the threats, the barge crew would have summoned the Interplanetary Transit Authority to arrest Sloane's crew on a variety of piracy-related charges. Sloane hadn't required the crew on the Casey to sign anything, but traveling with the captain was suspicious enough. Besides, Adda and Iridian had made their own share of trouble. The ITA wouldn't enforce the Near-Earth Union military draft, which Adda and Iridian were currently avoiding. They'd mete out the consequences they felt her and Iridian's colony ship hijacking warranted, and then turn them over to the NEU. While Iridian and Tritheist had kept the barge crew out of the Casey, Adda and Pell had watched the ship's console so they'd all have some warning when it was ready to leave. It had been Adda's last chance to confirm that Pell really wanted to stay with her. She and Iridian had fought long and hard to earn a place with Sloane's core pool of crew members, but Pell could have begged passage to another station.
"I've got money coming, and I've got to live somewhere," he'd said. "Might as well stick with you."
The ITA had almost caught them at Barbary Station, and everyone knew that Vesta was Captain Sloane's base of operations. All the ITA had to determine was which direction the crew would come from, and which vessel they'd travel in. Upon Ada's suggestion, the Casey had left the fuel barge on a long detour off the Mars Vesta reliable route. The trip across unpatrolled space had paid off. They hadn't seen the ITA since Barbary. Adda had never found out why the Casey had stopped at the fuel barge or what made it decide to leave. Traveling with an awakened intelligence was as unsettling as Adda's degree in AI development had led her to expect. "I can't tell if the Casey is planning to stay at Rhea Silvia Station," Adda said. "She's got her own fleet now." Pell still referred to the ship as she, like the rest of Sloane's crew did. The Casey's AI co-pilot was conscious enough to develop preferences, but it had ignored Adda's questions about its gender. "Three ships is a fleet, right?" Pell continued. "What does she need to hang out with a bunch of humans for?"
"Maintenance, obviously," said Tritheist. "Otherwise, she'd have left Barbary Station years ago."
Awakened artificial intelligence held different priorities and assessed more potential future actions than any human could. Even after Adda and Iridian fixed the Casey's internal communications system, the ship's intelligence hadn't spoken aloud. Two other ships with awakened intelligences, the Karen's Coin and the Apparition, followed at a distance. Neither of them had ever communicated directly with Sloane's crew. Their silence could mean anything. According to Iridian, most ships' windows projected whatever the ship was approaching above the bridge console, perpendicular to the floor, even though the ship was moving up from the passenger's perspective. That kept passengers who were accustomed to Earth-like gravity comfortable. Vesta's gray, pockmarked surface was approaching on the Casey's ceiling, recorded by a hull cam above their heads. The Casey approached Vesta as the minor planet's southern docking guides indicated, the path lit in a corner of its bridge console. Adda couldn't quite map the path above the console to the view projected above her. The massive asteroid looked utterly isolated in the star field around it. Flecks of red light representing buoys glinted between Vesta and the Casey stayed well away from them. Rhea Silvia Station was a white web of human construction that spanned nearly 100 kilometers of a 500-kilometer-wide, 13-kilometer-deep crater in Vesta's otherwise barren surface. A ship that must have been 10 times the Casey's size blocked most of the station from view as it descended into the crater and angled toward the docks. The Casey could have left the window projectors off. Its intelligence chose to accommodate them. On the console beneath the display, a comms connection between the Casey and the Rhea Silvia station docks activated. "On behalf of Oxia Corporation, welcome to Rhea Silvia Station," a voice announced over the Casey's cabin speakers, making Adda jump. Captain Sloane belted into the pilot's seat, frowned at the information projected on the wall in front of the bridge console, and muttered, "She already submitted it." The Casey could travel to its destinations without human assistance, but it'd only be allowed to dock if it appeared to have a human pilot. A scan configured to detect implants would show that Captain Sloane lacked the neural ones required to fly a ship, but everything she'd read indicated that most stations didn't use such intrusive scans. "Thank you," the captain said loudly enough for the console to pick it up and transmit it. "You should receive my ID and flight plan momentarily." Iridian tied the mesh bag of drone parts to the base of the ship's pseudo-organic tank. The tank's 150 liters of viscous fluid were almost, but not completely, still. Like most pseudo-organic tanks, the liquid seemed to swirl slowly at its center, although ripples never reached the edge of the pinkish-gray goo. Most tanks were lit from within to turn the pseudo-organic fluid a less disturbing color. But the Casey's tank lights had only ever been white. Nobody had worked up the nerve to reach in and replace the bulbs. While Adda collected small items that might be flung through the air at high speeds during a docking maneuver, Pell asked, "What does Oxia Corporation do?"
"Mining, infrastructure, and transport, predominantly, although they have other interests. They've been nosing around Vesta for years, but," Captain Sloane frowned, "they didn't always greet arriving ships.
Iridian helped Adda and Pell secure themselves against the wall alongside the empty wall-mounted docks for the ship's destroyed rover drones.
"Welcome back, Captain Sloane," said the voice over the Casey speakers.
The Oxia representative's voice was scratchier than it had been the first time. Like the first greeting had been a recording and this one was in real time. She sounded like she was about to cough or cry.
"We're sending your docking route now, Captain. Local time is 2:43.
"Hey, we're only 4 hours behind," Iridian, demonstrating more flexibility in a safety harness than Adda had believed possible, stretched to plant a kiss on the corner of Adda's mouth. The flash from a passing beacon touched Iridian's face, and her freckles stood out dark and lovely in the light.
"Here we go, babe. This is the kind of reception big-time pirates are supposed to get out here. We just jumped that silicate hauler to the front of the line."
Iridian nodded toward the much larger ship out the projected window. Adda squeezed her eyes shut. Beginnings and endings of spaceflight with gravity changing directions and objects outside the windows at strange angles made her nauseous. "That's unusual."
"They're serious about first-come, first-serve docking on Habs this far out, unless somebody's ship is in trouble," said Iridian. "Fuel's expensive and nobody likes to float in micrograv so near a Hab with healthy grav. So yeah, docking ahead of a ship that was here first is a perk."
Adda's comp glove buzzed with new message alerts, which was worth opening her eyes for. Projected message headers scrolled over the back of her hand, formatted to fit in the silver-bordered square opening in her dark purple fingerless glove. Pell's red comp glove erupted in a cacophony of cheerful alerts.
"We're online," he whooped. "Thank all the gods and devils, we have internet."
Although Adda could have corrected him that they'd been able to access it for the majority of the trip, and only the high-volume, non-emergency content was newly available, he looked too happy to care about the distinction. He freed both arms, though he left his torso and legs strapped to the wall to get his comp reading the alerts aloud. His comp should have picked up the entertainment content from the buoy network hours ago, Adda's had, so the KC must have been limiting their access until the ship was assigned a station dock. Tritheus passed by on his way to strap into the chair at the secondary console beside the bathroom door. Adda was more interested in her bank balance than her messages. She checked the balance almost hourly to confirm that the massive sum was still there. Piracy, even the non-traditional sort, paid as well as Pell had assured her it would. She encrypted and forwarded the account information through two proxy connections before it hit the buoy relay for the long trip through additional proxies to her father on Earth. A deep sigh pressed Adda's chest against her harness. She and Iridian could pay up on their student loans and stop the collection agents from hassling their families who had debts of their own. If working for Captain Sloane continued to pay this well, they, their parents, and most of their siblings could be out of debt in a matter of months. It was good to be part of the best pirate crew in populated space.
"Whoa, look at how far they've built down," said Iridian, "and up."
Outside the window, a massive metal latticework rose around them, the intricate web of buildings and support infrastructure that kept the station interior spinning left only glimpses of the large crater in which Rhea Silvia Station was built. Intersections between modules shone with white industrial lights much brighter than the distant sun. Rhea Silvia's sister station, Albana, was on the opposite side of the asteroid, making Rhea Silvia seem even more remote than it was, clinging to the crater wall and the bare Vestan soil. The Casey rotated to a new angle relative to the station. What Adda felt as down shifted to a 45-degree angle from where her brain told her it should be. She shut her eyes again. Pell's comp stopped reading message subject headers and started playing a news broadcast. "Return to Kiri Sekibo with the latest on the last Martian refugees repatriating from Barbary Station. Kiri?"
Hi, I'm here with Suhaila Almudari, spokesperson for the refugees who were trapped for 3 years by Barbary Station's aggressive artificial intelligence security system known as Egiscata. Ms. Almudari, what does it feel like to...
Forget the fugies, what about us? Pell asked over the newscaster.
Don't you want to hear how they're doing? Iridian asked.
They're fine, Pell said. Wasn't the station swarming with ITA right after we left? They don't leave people they rescue stuck out in space. And anyway, I've got 100 messages from them I haven't listened to yet, so I'll get all the juicy details. I want to hear what people are saying about the roguish pirates that made this all possible.
I've minimized our involvement, Captain Sloane said. Vestin Media has always been suggestible. When I've reestablished my position here, I may grant an interview personally.
Pell looked disappointed for about a quarter of a second, then asked, What does Suhaila look like again?
She looks normal, Iridian said. Stylish, for sure.
You're no help.
I've got your sister to look at. Why should I check out other ladies?
Pell groaned. I do not need to hear about you making heart eyes at my sister.
We're married, Iridian said in tones of real triumph and mock menace. That had been another accomplishment made on the trip to Vesta. The captain had been thoroughly amused to be asked to officiate. I'll be making hard eyes at her forever.
Between the two of them, the newscaster, and the ship changing course and orientation, Adda needed a distraction before she threw up.
According to the summary projected on the back of her hand through the comp glove's square window, Rhea Silvia Station was home to 300,000 people. That made it the largest off-Earth habitat she'd been to and the safest place in the universe for Sloane's crew, thanks to the local political ties the captain maintained. When she refocused on Pell and Iridian's conversation, Iridian was saying, All our eyes are a little fucked up. The cold and the black will do that to you.
Yeah, but even the Fuji kids used to ask why I didn't just get them fixed, said Pell. I need help walking so I don't run into things, and they hurt still. It's annoying, and it's annoying to talk about all the time.
A station the size of Rhea Silvia had to have surgeons and regrowth clinics that could fix Pell's eyes.
Anyway, who says I want my old eyes back? He continued. I can afford great pseudo-organics now. No reason to keep what I was born with just because.
At the bridge console, Sloane's voice changed from casual to casual covering emotion. We're carrying passengers tonight, yes? Didn't you receive our permit code?
Adda sub-vocalized the terms to her comp and scanned the Interplanetary Transit Authority's passenger vessel requirements. The small ITA contingent in Rhea Silvia's docks should have stopped and inspected passenger ships that lacked a permit and special insurance. The bribes Sloane's crew paid should protect the KC and its crew, but Adda didn't want to risk putting the ITA agents in that position. Apparently the captain didn't either. Sloane had been off Vesta for a long time. Things might have changed. To keep herself occupied during the trip from Barbary Station, Adda had scoped out the ITA's data banks. After careful trial and one or two frightening errors, she'd exploited a backdoor entry into several corners of the ITA's internal system. As the newest system's infiltrator on a pirate crew, she expected to get good use out of that access to humanity's largest semi-official law enforcement organization. She hadn't planned to use it this soon, but it was the best solution she saw to the problem at hand.
I'll send the code again, Captain Sloane said more loudly. Our co-pilot caught a virus, you see.
A string of letters and numbers appeared on Adda's comp. She gasped, and Iridian said something. Adda's hands shook while she inserted the code and the Casey's ID into the ITA's system.
Apology accepted, Sloane said in the direction of the bridge console's mic. We'll proceed.
Fucking unnecessary, Tritheist grumbled.
Babe, talk to me.
Iridian shook Adda by the shoulder. Are you okay?
Adda nodded slowly. The Casey got into my comp again. The awakened intelligence had broken through her new defenses around her data,
and she didn't even know when it had happened. Her motion sickness returned at full strength. Strange sensations in her neural implant net could be a side effect of extended periods in close contact with awakened intelligences. As far as she knew, she was the first person ever to have spent this much time with one. That was the terrifying, exciting beauty of traveling with them. She should take more notes. Beside her, Iridian swore and muttered, "That invasive, invisible, parasitic." It also helped us create a passenger transport permit so we wouldn't be stopped. That meant that the Casey had been listening to what they said in the cabin, watching Adda's comp activity, and drawing accurate conclusions about what Adda was doing. And then it had created an unused ID in the correct format, which might have taken Adda more time than she'd had. Even though the Casey's intelligence crawling through her personal hardware was a violation, she felt obligated to defend it. The Casey's intelligence and those of the other two ships from Barbary Station were likely the only awakened intelligences in the universe. She refused to put them at risk of deactivation by anyone, even her wife. Footsteps approached from the bridge. Captain Sloane clutched recessed handholds in the wall to maintain balance in the shifting G-forces the Casey generated as it flew toward their designated dock. While Adda had been concentrating on her comp, the captain had donned a full suit of gold and black armor, covered with the long coat Adda associated with captaincy. Like Tritheist, the captain's helmet faceplate was raised to communicate without a comms system. Equipment and supplies clanked and thumped below deck. "We'll dock shortly, but I've recommended to the Casey that she depart afterward," Captain Sloane said. "We should leave the docks and enter the main part of the station quickly as well." "Something up, sir?" Iridian was still working on shaking her military habit of calling everyone sir unless they looked significantly feminine. Captain Sloane looked solidly non-binary. "I don't love flying around in a ship that could break all our brains if it tried hard enough, but it's the only one we have." "As I've been unable to confirm that port authorities have been suitably compensated for our convenience," the captain said. Adda interpreted "compensated" as "bribed." "There's some possibility that we'll receive a well-armed welcome from one or more local interests. We have nothing to gain by waiting for a firefight, but I'd rather the Casey not sustain damage and retaliate against us or the station." That was one of many possible reactions, all equally likely and difficult to predict. The Casey didn't have guns of its own as far as Adda knew, but its awakened AI didn't need weapons to cause damage. "You're assuming it'll stay or go because I ask it to," Adda said. Captain Sloane gave her an incredulous look and she shrugged. She wished she had a better answer, but she was as worried as the captain probably was about what the Casey would do. She had a lot of experience with normal AIs. There were no experts on awakened ones.
"Who's suicidal enough to shoot at us?"
Tritheist gripped the handle of a chem canister launcher at his hip. He scowled toward the interior door to the pass-through, the half-a-hallway structure that connected to a dock's half-a-hallway to create an airlock, like he expected someone to break in.
"This is your dock, on your station."
Sloane shrugged. The casual gesture magnified in the armored suit and at odds with the way the captain watched the bridge console, where threats would be projected on a simplified map. "It's been 2 years since I was in a position to supervise crew assets personally, and I've had difficulty reconnecting with my usual information sources. People become ambitious." Captain Sloane pointedly looked from Adda to Iridian. "I've not yet risked contacting my headquarters since we left Barbary." The lead cloud surrounding Barbary Station would have made Sloane's contact with whoever was left in charge of the crew's headquarters sporadic at best. It would have been impossible without the Casey, who had occasionally carried messages out to the rest of the universe. While Iridian helped Adda and Pell free themselves from the wall, Sloane murmured something in Tritheist's ear, knocked two knuckles against the lieutenant's armored chest, and returned to the bridge console.
First thing's a station sex scan, Tritheist announced, as if the three people he was lecturing weren't a meter or two away from his face. Most of the weapons are in a shielded compartment, and that should be all the illegals we're carrying. But we've never scanned the Casey ourselves, so we don't know what she's got hidden. Stay calm. Keep your hands visible. Move slow.
Yes, sir. Iridian's hint of sarcasm was too small for Tritheist to call her out for it, but if even Adda identified it, then it also couldn't be missed. The whole ship felt as if it had turned abruptly on its side, and sickening weightlessness returned as the Casey slowed to a near stop. Adda's hair, which fell over her eyes in Earth-like gravity, drifted up and out of her way. Iridian's shaved scalp kept her looking as powerful and confident as usual. Tritheist kept talking. Iridian would tell Adda anything she needed to know later. If there were any hidden compartments in the Casey's main cabin, they were well hidden from Adda's perspective. The ship's comprehensive communications suite and the manacles installed on the bathroom wall suggested that the Casey was designed for espionage. Three awakened shipboard intelligences had left Barbary Station with Sloane's crew, but only this co-pilot intelligence had changed its own name. The Casey smuggling a previous owner's contraband was a real possibility. Scanning now, Sloane said. It doesn't affect their work, but they prefer that we stay relatively still. As soon as Sloane and Tritheist looked back to the bridge console, Pell waved his arms above his head. Adda yanked the one she could reach down to his side. Grow up, she whispered.
Never! We should have been cleared by now, Captain, Tritheist grumbled.
Formalities must be addressed, said Captain Sloane, particularly if my influence on dock security has diminished.
Dock sec should be keeping the ITA pricks occupied like they fucking used to. Where do they think their pay comes from? It's sure as hell not ITA, that's the point of joint station space control. All they have to do is get us through the damned docks. Useless.
Tritheus lapsed into spacefarer cant, which was multilingual gibberish to Adda. The window projected onto the wall replaced the view of the dock pass-through's exterior wall slowly moving past them with route records. This route had taken them through most of the near-Earth Union, with a stopover on Mars before exiting NEU territory en route to Vesta, one of several populated asteroids in the asteroid belt. That trip would have been much longer than their actual route, which had cut across the reliable routes between Vesta and Barbary Station. Adda hadn't told the Casey to do that either. She sub-vocalized to her virtual intermediary to see if it could find any indications as to how and why the Casey was making those decisions. AI was frequently incomprehensible even when they wanted to be understood, but it was worth trying. The bridge console pinged three times in quick succession. Captain Sloane looked at Tritheist, who skimmed through some text projected in the center of his black comp glove.
That's cleared to engage pass-through locks, Captain.
The Casey was completing the docking maneuver on its own, but Sloane still had to act like a pilot to avoid raising suspicions among the Rhea Silvia Station dock personnel. Captain Sloane nodded once.
So the ITA are satisfied. My people have done the minimum required to facilitate our arrival. Now I wonder who might be waiting in the terminal.
Sloane stepped through the Casey's open interior door and stopped on one side of the pass-through's exterior door, which was still closed. Tritheist stood on the other side, skimming a map on his comp glove.
This isn't our dock, is it?
The lieutenant's question sounded more like a grim acknowledgement than an effort to clarify. Sloane's shoulders slumped slightly, matching the captain's resigned frown.
It is not.
Iridian stepped into the pass-through with them. Although three was the maximum number of people the ship's airlock could comfortably hold.
How can you tell?
This is my home, said Captain Sloane. I know how the route to my terminal feels.
We've been off Barbary Station long enough for news to make it here, Iridian said.
Unlike the ITA stationed here, The Rhea Silvia Constabulary and whomever is behind them know who I am.
Sloane's voice was calm, but the captain's flushed face could mean anger or embarrassment. Possibly both. Vesta should have been their safe haven. Adda sighed as she let go of that particular hope.
Weapons? Captain Sloane added.
Iridian took long steps to a compartment in the bedroom. She tossed bowl-shaped palmers of the pirate's design to Sloane and Tritheist. The weapons fit into the palm of one hand and disabled human targets with some kind of invisible particle beam when fired. She kept one for herself and padded her shield, currently collapsed, into a small rectangle of folded metal hanging on her belt hook. Another palmer was still in the shielded compartment, but Adda's aim wasn't much better than Pell's. Sloane fitted a palmer on over one armored glove with the bowl shape facing outward, then gripped a handhold in the pass-through wall.
Tritheist, Iridian, Adda, you will join me in a meeting with the current station leadership to determine who allowed this inconvenience to occur. If killing someone will stop this incompetence, I will do it.
Adda inquired very carefully through her digital intermediary whether the Casey would be able to subsume whatever AI-coordinated Rhea Silvia station's law enforcement. With intelligences, there was a very fine line between ability to do something and do something now. But if Captain Sloane were expecting violence, now would be the time to risk that miscommunication. The intermediary reappeared, from Adda's perspective, in the center of the Casey's cabin. It thrust its hand into her comp glove through her own hand, with no sensation to accompany the motion since she was in reality not a virtual workspace. Her comp screen filled with several hundred links to vids and articles about awakened, or nearly awakened, AI that had been summarily executed by humanity and their networked zombie intelligences.
You've made your point, Adda murmured to the Casey's AI co-pilot.
Intelligences didn't experience fear, but their developers granted them a degree of self-preservation, which awakening should strengthen. Although the Casey might be willing and able to overpower Rhea Silvia Station's management AI, doing so carried too big a risk of strangers discovering the Casey's awakened status and subsequently destroying it. That was a more specific hint at the Casey's decision-making motivations than she'd expected her intermediary to find. The intermediary also delivered results of the Casey's dock system's scan. Everything from the maintenance schedule to the buoy guidance system carried Oxia's markings. The corporation only stored its most essential short-term data locally. The whole exchange between Adda and the intermediary had taken less than 10 seconds. Iridian returned to her strap-in station beside Adda and pointed at a red symbol that had appeared over the window projection beside the pass-through. It was a square with a stick-figure person, arms and legs extended in an X shape, hovering in its center.
When you see that symbol, it means you're losing some grav within the next 60 seconds, said Iridian. It's mostly gone already. Vesta's grav is pretty low, like a tenth of Earth's moon grav, I think.
Is there a sound for that, too? Asked Pell. She can put up all the symbols she wants, and they won't tell me a thing.
You know, I've never heard the Casey use audio alerts, said Iridian. If we have to get back on this thing again, maybe Adda can ask it to add those.
Adda gripped the straps over her shoulders, but the worst gravity shifts were over. The wall and floor were in their correct position, and they barely shuddered as the Casey's pass-through connected to the station and the docking complete notification lit beside the interior pass-through door. The pass-through's exterior door clunked and whirred open. Iridian activated her boot magnets and freed herself from her harness. Her kiss bumped the back of Adda's head against the wall.
We made it this far.
She crouched to activate the magnets on Adda's boots and help her down. Gravity's pull toward the floor was so slight that it justified the Casey's warning. Adda turned toward the bridge console on reflex, although the intelligence was listening on active mics throughout the ship.
Casey, we may need to leave quickly. Will you wait here 15 minutes? She glanced at Sloane, who nodded. The Casey added a countdown timer to the console projection of ship statuses and the starscape framed in Rhea Silvia Station's interconnecting architecture.
What are you doing? Deploying AI without the captain's order?
Tritheist snarled. Sloane put a hand on his arm, pushing him away from Adda in the low gravity. Tritheist staggered backward as his boots gripped the metal floor. She's welcome to create as many emergency exits as she's able.
With respect, Captain, that AI is dangerous.
Tritheist's tone and volume softened to communicate deference. Fucking A, Iridian muttered. As are we all, said Captain Sloane. Pell beamed at this assessment from his tangle of straps and limbs in the strap-down station against the wall. The long coat drifted around the captain's boots in Vesta's low gravity as Sloane, Iridian, and Tritheist walked through the Casey's pass-through and into the terminal, Iridian in front with her collapsed shield on her belt. Adda, feeling distinctly harmless in their company, helped Pell peel himself off the wall to follow them. Cams mounted prominently on the terminal walls recorded an empty room outside the pass-through. The words, Oxia Corporation welcomes you to Rhea Silvia Station, accompanied by a shape that looked like a flower with three petals, were physically printed onto wall paneling that amplified the crew's steps in the empty space. Sloane's lip curled into a cultured grimace of disgust as the captain read the message. The terminal's far door, presumably leading to the rest of the station, was closed. No one waited there to greet them. If Sloane's second-in-command on Vesta wanted to welcome them back, she should have at least sent a lackey with VIP passes for public transportation. And if she wanted to alert station security to the crew's presence without alarming Captain Sloane, then she should have sent an expendable lackey. The empty terminal felt like a trap, but not one arranged by whomever Sloane was planning to meet. Adda caught Sloane's eye and hoped she looked less afraid than she felt. We're leaving, yes? Sloane passed them on the way into the Casey's pass-through, pulling Tritheist through an abrupt turn toward the ship with a grip on his elbow. We are. Wait, what? Pell said. We just got here. There's a bar in the nightlife module where... Adda grabbed his wrist while Iridian pulled the folded metal rectangle from her belt. When Iridian shook the folded metal, it expanded into a semi-transparent shield that covered most of Pell and Adda while Iridian held it between them and the empty terminal. Adda smiled her thanks. Iridian's shield stance with her bent knees, feet apart, strong arm raised, and hard, dark eyes was a thing to behold. Something slapped into the shield near Iridian's elbow. Her arm thumped into Adda's and Pell's chests, and they both tumbled up the ramp after Sloane and Tritheist. Iridian swore and dragged the shield along the outer pass-through door's frame like she was scraping something off it. Get in! She inhaled like she was going to shout something else, but a small explosion drowned her out. Fragments clattered off the pass-through walls and into the Casey's main cabin, the low gravity cluttering the air with them as well as the floor and ceiling. Iridian bounced off the far wall and caught the base of the Casey's pseudo-organic tank to stop herself from careening back into the pass-through. The pinkish-gray liquid in the tank sloshed against its sealed lid. The exterior door thumped shut. The Casey's engines hadn't had time to cool, so its passengers needed to strap in before the takeoff bounced them off walls, too. Adda pulled Pell toward the strap-in stations across from the pass-through and stuck one of the straps in his hand. Hey, I am literally in the dark, said Pell. What's going on? We're under attack, Adda said. Captain, do you think it's station security, ITA, or someone else? Since they attempted to apprehend us quietly, Sloane called from the bridge console, that rules out the ITA. Explosives didn't fit into Adda's definition of quiet, but this seemed like a bad time to argue with the captain. Tritheist swept small pieces of metal from the air and pocketed them on his way to the seat at the desk console on the opposite end of the main cabin. Iridian stood and slammed her fist on the control panel beside the pass-through. The pass-through's inner door shut with a low hiss. Her bare head and hands bled red droplets that drifted toward the floor.
I hate getting blown up. Let's go.
Adda pulled a coiled cable from its hiding place in her heavy silver necklace. One end plugged into her comp glove, and she threaded the other into her pinky finger-sized nasal jack. The chrome jack connected her neural implant net directly into her comp glove's system, which let her work faster than she could have with external inputs alone. She subvocalized a command to her comp to recreate her gray intermediary, which appeared in the main cabin. Only she could see it. Today, its human-like figure had Captain Sloane's broad shoulders and long flowing hair, which whisked around the figure in the still cabin air as she directed it to interface with the Casey's intelligence. Iridian stomped across the ship in her magnetic boots, bleeding and scowling and beautiful and terrible. Adda stood in mute admiration until Iridian pressed her back into her harness. It had perhaps been too long a trip in the company of Ada's employer and little brother. The lack of a honeymoon to go with her wedding was surprisingly distracting. Iridian barely got Pell and herself strapped in before the ship lurched backward, forward, except behind them? God, there was no right way to describe ship motion without math, and disconnected its pass-through from the dock. From the pilot's rotating seat at the bridge console, Sloane called, "Adda, calm interference would be convenient." "On it," Adda said. The Casey was capable of handling that itself, but it hadn't so far. "Are you listening? Flashlights once for yes," Adda murmured. She startled when the whole cabin went dark for a second. "What the fuck was that?" Tritheus shouted. "Roll call," Adda said so quietly that only Pell and Iridian reacted. Pell with a nervous laugh, and Iridian with the frown she wore every time they discussed AI. The Casey's transmitters were occupied with a long-range comm already in progress, and it stopped Adda from reallocating any of its comm capabilities to interfere with law enforcement broadcasts. None of the human occupants' comps were connected to the system as far as Adda could tell through her intermediary. The Casey was communicating with parties unknown. Adda settled for a comp-based program, which triggered other transmitters as they came in range to create radiating signal waves. It was the best she could do for now. With gravity pulling on her harder than ever at the speed the Casey was flying, taking one of the thumbprint-sized purple squares from her sharpsheet case was tricky. Adda laid the pre-measured dose on her tongue and activated systems interface programs on her comp while the sharpsheet sizzled and dissolved. The window projected across the pass-through door, and the wall opposite Adda displayed Rhea Sylvia Station's metallic latticework whizzing by so close to the Casey's hull cams that Adda flinched. Some spaces between beams looked large enough for the Casey to fly through, although Adda fervently hoped it wouldn't. They rocketed over the lip of the crater, revealing a horizon much closer than Adda's Earth upbringing had led her to expect. Then the Casey dove back into the maze of Rhea Sylvia's industrial installations, which branched toward acres of solar panels surrounding the station. The floor in front of the doors to the bedroom and bathroom lit up with a projection of two small wedge-shaped ships. Piercingly bright red and blue lights lit the Oxia Corporation logo on the ship's sides. It wasn't the ITA's insignia, at least. The ship's outlines were highlighted in a dashed red and blue line, a visual code that law enforcement vessels throughout populated space used to identify themselves. The sharpsheet's effects shivered through her mind and begged for a focus. Adda closed her eyes to concentrate on finding and scrambling their pursuer's calm frequency. A few minutes later, a jolt and a horrifyingly loud scraping sound from the ceiling made her eyes open wide. The ceiling currently felt like more of a side than up or down. The wall behind her shook. The cam projecting above her head showed metal tubes that curved up on either edge of the view. Something crunched and the ceiling turned into a black void for several seconds until the Casey shut off the projector. "We didn't break off something important, did we?"
The fear in Pell's voice persuaded Adda to sacrifice accuracy for comfort.
Whatever it was didn't slow us down. She had to yell over the continuous dragging scrape, which now came from both above and below them.
It stopped abruptly. The projection by the doors showed the opposite direction of the one they were going in.
Gods, how did spacefarers define that?
And displayed a passage between two loops of metal that looked too narrow for a human to stand in. The calm traffic her comp projected across the back of her hand indicated that the passage was giving the station security vehicles pause. Adda closed her eyes, relying on sub-vocalized commands to redirect her calm interference efforts as needed.
Captain, how many of the evasion maneuvers are up to you?
Iridian asked, referring to pre-programmed ones that pilots could activate at will, according to stories Adda had read.
None, Sloane said.
The bridge console appears to be disconnected from maneuvering controls. Iridian squirmed against the wall beside Adda. Adda risked a glance at her and mostly saw her knuckles whitening around the straps at her shoulder before nausea forced Adda's eyes closed again.
Casey, said Iridian, don't get us killed.
Chapter 2. Full integration with individual crew comms achieved. 051-877-0416. Tied to a bulkhead while an AI self-destructs around you is no way to die. The thought kept going through Iridian's head. She had nothing else to think about while the gods-damned Casey flung itself through station space above Vesta's largest hab, running from smaller and more nimble pursuers who'd have no trouble finding the only passenger transport within an AU that was flying like an enforcer drone.
We can't keep this up, Tritheist said.
It always felt wrong when she and Sloane's lieutenant agreed on something, but he'd spoken the truth.
The Casey's got EMP shielding, but it doesn't have guns, she pointed out. Where's the apparition? And was that the Oxia Corp logo on those cop carriers?
Good questions, Adda said, almost too quietly to hear. Her eyes snapped open. We need to find the apparition. That's where we're going.
Should have known the Casey wouldn't run at random.
AIs rarely randomize something this important, Adda said. Iridian snorted a laugh. On the bridge projector, clicks of intertwined station mechanisms and ship maintenance apparatuses retreated behind them at unsettling speed. Station Sec hadn't shot at them so far. The Casey was using the station's architecture as cover.
Adda thinks the Casey's meeting up with the apparition to scrape those people off its hull, Iridian said. If we're betting, my money's on the warship.
Mine too, Tritheist growled over the local comm channel.
My money would be on the apparition as well, but violence is not my first choice. I'm interested in reclaiming my position, not obliterating it. Whether or not the Casey was listening in on the conversation, it maintained its speed and direction. Iridian clenched her teeth and tamped down panic. Strong AIs could do a lot on their own, and it made them damned unpredictable, even when they weren't awakened, like the Casey's co-pilot. The captain tapped the console and replaced the retreating station exterior on the bridge projection with newsfeed headlines and messages about the crew member who'd been in charge of Vesta in Sloane's absence.
Send us that feed? Adda asked.
What feed? Said Pell. While Sloane shared the projected documents with Adda, Adda explained the news to Pell, and the Casey made several sharp turns. Iridian read,
So, your crew's been ransacking the locals as well as the NEU ships, Captain?
Iridian wished she could have sounded less angry. Sloane had done everything possible to control crew resources from Barbary Station, but intermittent communication opportunities had made that impossible for years. And sure, all megacorporations were technically NEU because their headquarters were on Earth, Mars, Mercury, or Venus. But it wasn't like the crew had been blowing apart NEU ships full of civilians like the secessionists had during the war. The problem was that megacorps could afford a few raids. The Vestans couldn't.
Neither Sloane nor Tritheist looked up from the news feed, so she activated the eye highlight function of her helmet's comms software. It drew a moving, humming border around the vid clip she was looking at, a Vestin Microcorp's cargo carrier wreck engulfed in a blue orb of chemical flame. Behind the burning wreck was a piece of the web-like station architecture that Casey had just flown over. The headline read, 23 dead, and Sloane's crew was implicated in the first line. Quite a feat for my crew, while most of my operatives were occupied elsewhere and I never gave that order, said Sloane. The captain and Tritheist scowled and braced in their harnesses as the KC shifted directions fast enough to black everyone out for a second. Contacting your headquarters would put us at additional risk of ITA exposure, Adda said, apropos of nothing and sounding sick as all hells from the grav shifts. My secure line should still be in place. Captain Sloane was apparently on the same track as Adda. The Casey dropped straight toward Vesta's surface for several endless seconds. Iridian braced against her harness and swore. Adda was mumbling to herself or her comp. Every time she said something almost intelligible and paused for breath, the Casey zigged or zagged. The overhead cam was still out, but Iridian could have picked out individual grains of dirt on the deck cam, which was actually projected on the deck for a change, if the ship weren't screaming over it like an Atmo escape launch. What are you doing, babe? Exterior processing. They all jerked to the right in their restraints, and a fountain of gray dirt bloomed at the edge of the projection on the bulkhead across from them. Busy. The message is sent, Captain Sloane said. A 10-centimeter fragment of whatever had blown up against Iridian's shield in the station terminal clattered around the main cabin, where Pell and Adda were unarmored and had their arms strapped down. Iridian freed one of hers and missed the fragment twice as it flew by. It finally slapped into her gloved palm as the whole ship lurched. Vesta's cratered surface filled the bridge projection for a long moment before the stars and horizon appeared on the deck projection. What did Station Sec hit us with? She asked. Maneuvering system virus, primarily, Adda muttered. Sloane had no chance of hearing Adda when she talked that quietly and spoke over her. Projectile ammo with very minimal impact. It may have been targeting stabilizers or aft altitude control. The captain pressed and dragged a few spots on the bridge console. When nothing in the ship or out of it changed, Sloane sighed and gripped the pilot chair's armrests. It's AI built, but it was a zombie AI, said Adda. Zombie AIs were just AIs to most people. They all should have had physical and programmed limitations to prevent the development of volition. AI was never supposed to be awakened. The Casey's removing it now. In the meantime, how likely are we to crash land in the airless desert below? Captain Sloane asked with remarkable calm. Can't tell, Adda went back to sub-vocalizing to her comp. The speakers near the bridge console chimed a standard signal for an async comm. Sloane opened it and a new voice said, Hello, boss, around an audible sneer. The man was older than Iridian and Adda put together, late 60s or early 70s. His light skin clashed with his hair's shade of blue. Subdermal flame-shaped implants jutted out from his face where he should have had eyebrows, and they were too big to be decorative. They'd have some other function as well. Captain Sloane said, Rose Hatch. Anger, mostly hidden except for a stillness the captain rarely demonstrated, even when dead calm. The man on the monitor lounged at a desk someplace with healthy enviro, judging by his lack of an enviro suit.
Waiting for your bot cops to call off the chase?
Sloane's chin jerked downward relative to the pilot's seat rather than Vesta, since the Casey was almost perpendicular to the asteroid's surface.
The ones behind us will be destroyed if they persist.
Oxia Corp won't miss them. Even Station Sec disappear on this jet some nights, and it won't come back on my crew.
Iridian's lips pulled away from her teeth in a sympathetic grimace. From the way Rose Hatch addressed the captain, this was a former member of Sloane's crew. Now he was claiming Sloane's position of power on Vesta. Pell and Tritheist swore. Adda glanced at Iridian and asked, "Ject? As in astronomical object?"
"Yeah, but nobody says that," Iridian replied.
Adda nodded and returned her attention to her comp. The captain said, "I see." Rosehatch grinned, self-satisfied and wanting more.
"You know why Station Sec's chasing you? The station councils don't move the stars and planets for you anymore is why. You kept them waiting, what, 2 years? For somebody to tell them what to do? Last year, Oxia stepped up and told them Sloane's crew was the only muscle that made its cut when the Corp took Vesta over, not counting the Station Sec contracts. They made me sign one, too. So, since you took a long vacay and left it lying around, I own the crew now."
The Casey jolted, grav spiked, and Iridian's vision went black. When Iridian next opened her eyes, Tritheist was shouting,
"Kill everyone he's ever met and choke him on their ashes,"
from his seat at the desk across from the Casey's bridge. The stranger who'd claimed Sloane's crew as his own was gone from the console's projection stage, although that hadn't stopped Tritheist from yelling at him. She'd only been out for a minute, probably. Her head throbbed in time with her heartbeat. "Are you okay?" Adda stood on the overhead from Iridian's perspective, although Iridian couldn't tell if the magnets in Adda's boots were activated or not. What grab Vesta had was pulling all the blood into Iridian's head.
"Yeah. Did we land?" Iridian asked.
"If you mean stopped moving while upside down in a ditch, then yeah, we landed."
Pell drifted back and forth across the Casey's main cabin, pushing off the bulkheads with his outstretched hands and bouncing off the deck with his toes instead of landing. Iridian reoriented to down being the former overhead, which made magnetic boots unnecessary.
Adda steadied Iridian while she let herself down from the bulkhead. "It's a very large ditch."
Sloane tore free of the pilot's seat harness and stood, gripping the underside of the bridge console to stabilize in Vesta's low grav. The sudden movement stilled everyone, Tritheist included.
"Rose Hatch dies for this."
The captain's words were spaced wide and spoken slowly, like an oath. "But he's less important than freeing the crew from Oxia Corporation." Iridian clenched her teeth against disappointment and the pain in her head. The crew was trapped again, after they'd just fought their way out of a god's damned hellhole of a station to this one where life should have gotten a whole lot better. Good people had died getting the five of them to Vesta. The reality of the new situation reverberated through her like she'd hit the ground after a long fall. The crew was supposed to be choosing their own objectives, making profits and threats that'd keep them free of megacorps like Oxia. Instead, they'd lost that battle before the first shot was fired, because this Rosehatch person had sold the crew out from under them. Tritheist finished a slow forward flip that straightened out his twisted harness.
"We should kill him now, Captain. He'll only make things harder for us if we don't."
Rosehatch sure as hell had that coming.
"Hate to agree with the LT," Iridian said, "but he's..."
The Casey's bridge projection replaced the gray wall of the ditch it had put itself down in with energy readouts, model descriptions of ships that didn't match its type at all, a countdown, and a vid in the corner of three cop carriers flying low over Vesta's surface.
"Did it add the visuals?"
Adda stared at her comp, which she was still plugged into via her nasal jack. "We disagreed on their importance." After the awkward 2 days the Casey had spent stuck to a fuel barge after it had finished refueling, Iridian expected the Casey to do what it wanted, when it wanted. That didn't mean anybody liked it when the damn ship got confused or willful or whatever its problem was.
"Yeah, visuals are up on the bridge," said Iridian.
Adda could have looked up from her comp and seen them if she weren't busy pretending she was in an invisible workspace generator.
Station 6 coming this way? Adda nodded. Then strap in again. We need someplace to hide.
Perhaps Rosehatch will provide us with a location, said Captain Sloane. Iridian stopped halfway through climbing into her harness.
Say again?
Her question was accompanied by Pels. We're asking him, and Tritheist asking,
but why?
If the smile on Sloane's face were directed at her, she would have deployed her shield and taken cover. Once he learns how easily I escaped his trap, he'll realize that he needs me, or that he needs to trap me in person.
Captain, Station Sec is almost on top of us, Iridian pointed at the map with moving icons for approaching ships.
Sloane turned back to the bridge console.
Then he'll need to reach that realization quickly. Casey, or Adda, whoever is listening, put me back in contact with Rosehatch. I assume my methods are on record.
So everything they did on this ship was recorded. Damn that nosy AI. But once again, the Casey was going out of its way to help them. Adda said it was difficult to tell why awakened AIs did anything, but the Casey had spent too many resources protecting them to let them die without a good reason. Unless the Casey was taken by the ITA, Iridian and Adda were probably not in imminent danger from it. He might turn over crew operations to Sloane. Adda paused to struggle with her harness until Iridian reached over to help. For the sake of efficiency, I mean.
He's not that smart, Tritheist grumbled.
Rosehatch, I've a counter offer for you. Reply at your convenience. Sloane tapped several places on the console, which was blank instead of covered with icons like a normal ship's would be, until the sent notification appeared in the projection.
I trust you'll remove the last moments of that recording.
Done, Adda murmured. The hair on the back of Iridian's neck stood on end. The Casey had had several drones when Iridian had first encountered it, but they'd been destroyed in a fight on their way out of Barbary Station. When Casey had used one as a mouthpiece, it had said things with as few words and emotion as possible. It had sounded a lot like Adda just did. Iridian reached to pat the first part of Adda she could reach, which was her knee.
Hey, how about you unplug for a while?
We'll move faster if I don't, Adda said. Plugging into a console would help. Do you think my cable would reach the console, Jack?
Iridian shuddered. The Casey's already doing things a human pilot couldn't, and keeping us more or less upright and conscious. What in all hells makes you think physically plugging your brain into an awakened AI is necessary?
I won't have a brain if the Casey's vid recognition can't determine what the police vehicles are doing as fast as I can. If my choice is death or AI influence, I'll go with the... Adda watched the comp projection in the square stage on the back of her glove for several seconds. The hand in her glove clenched into a fist.
What's happening?
Our pursuers seem to be returning to the station, Captain Sloane said. The projected view of the retreating Station Sec ships confirmed it.
Rosehatch has accepted my proposal. If the Casey could deliver us to one of the mine docks, we'll get this meeting over with.
So we're buying him out, Captain? Iridian asked.
Ideally, Sloane said. Unless he's much improved his information-gathering capabilities since I've been gone, he'll underestimate our ability to defend ourselves. I'm still not opposed to killing him if the opportunity arises.
Good, said Tritheist.
Beyond them, lights out but occluding the stars, the apparition's asymmetrical silhouette hung still in station space. It could have blasted the cop carriers to microscopic pieces. The Karen's coin had to be nearby, too. Maneuvering around a mega corporate empire would be at least as difficult as fighting Barbary Station's security AI. And just like on Barbary, the ships had done the absolute minimum to help. Two out of three were ignoring the crew's current predicament. AIs couldn't be trusted.
Hell of a place to meet, Pell shouted over the processing machinery crunching basalt all around them.
tubes big enough to crawl through looped around one another through the depths of the mine beneath Rhea Silvia Station. After a quick unloading at the mine's terminal and a long elevator ride, they were half a click from being the deepest into Vesta that any humans had ever stood. At unpredictable intervals, pressurized tubes hauled Vesta's primary export out of the dark and dropped the chunks of basalt into sifting and crushing machines. The noise masked the distinctive armor rattling that Iridian, Captain Sloane, and Tritheist made as they walked. Pell and Adda, protected more by the fighters' presence than by their jackets with light armor mesh lining, stayed a few steps behind. At the front of the group, Iridian kept her head turning to watch for threats. The mine was full of movement and had plenty of places to hide. Five or six third-shift workers managing the robots and machines practically knelt at Sloane's feet, so far as grav allowed, to offer masks off their own faces. Even the masks bore Oxia's three-bladed fan logo. The captain nodded gravely, but the Atmo filters in Sloane's helmet would be more effective than anything the miners had.
"Welcome back, Captain," an older worker said.
Her voice grated like the rock traveling through the tubes around them. The pause in her greeting suggested that she'd been acquainted with Sloane before the captain claimed that title. Sloane had been looking over the workers' heads, watching for trouble the way Tritheist and Iridian were, but the captain refocused on the worker who'd spoken. "How does Oxia treat you?"
"New contracts, longer hours, minimum pay."
The worker's sigh rattled in a way that made Iridian want to take the woman's mask and replace its filters.
"Oxia wants everything Vesta's got, underground and over it, and the station councils do whatever they say. Easy to keep a woman on eject. She can't afford to leave, even without the damned contract."
Sloane frowned sympathetically and waved a hand at the machinery around them. "New equipment as well?" The worker nodded.
"Recycling the old stuff and installing new means they got more right to the ground under it, so says the news feeds and the council and ITA and the gods themselves, seems like. Feeds say the new machines will shake the ject apart too, though, so who knows, yeah? Oxia's fancy new diggers don't fix their own troubles any better than the old ones. Dust crowds out the nanites. But now,"
the worker raised her eyes to meet Sloane's,
"we're counting on you."
She backed off toward the elevator with the others. The workers offered Adda a mask too, but she held up her hands, palms out. Once the worker stepped away, she murmured, "They breathe and sweat in those." She still sounded distant, like she'd spent hours in a workplace instead of strapped down in a ship. "Who knows what's sitting on your side of the filters waiting to be pulled into your lungs? I'd rather breathe some dust."
"Ah, yuck," said Pell. "Is it too late to give mine back?"
Iridian's glance around the complex did not reveal the worker who'd given Pell his mask, or the one who offered one to her despite her armor, for that matter. "Yeah, it looks like everybody cleared out." The maze of densely woven machinery mirrored the way Vesta's two stations shuffled spacefaring humanity and cargo too mundane or dangerous for Ceres through the asteroid belt. And the surface's fractal latticework separated the two. Captain Sloane caught her looking over the mining setup and said, "We're currently out of range of almost all the station's monitoring hardware. Useful for our sort." At their last port of call, their lives had depended on knowing which modules had active sensor nodes, so Iridian could appreciate that. The mine must have been miserable for Pell, though. It'd be hard to hear anyone coming over the machinery.
"So glad you could join us,"
said the spacefarer-accented male voice they'd last heard over the KC speakers. Iridian swore and spun to face the newcomer, shield deploying before her in a satisfying thump she felt through her wrist and arm. It pushed her into a staggered backward step in the low grav. The flame-shaped implants above Rose Hatch's eyes cast shadows over them.
The bumps on the backs of his hands might have been projectors for a comp, and he was sure to have other additions buried deeper or under clothes. The short-handled machete hanging against his thigh was her current concern. It wouldn't crack her armor, but it had cut Adda's and Pell's unprotected throats. The us referred to the two bodyguards flanking Rosehatch. The little one had a body like a burlesque dancer's beneath flexible light armor and carried enough blades to stick everyone in the mine and still have one left over for cleaning under her nails. The magnets in her boots were either off or on low power, and she looked so light on her feet she was practically levitating. The big one carried an armor buster that Iridian couldn't recall the name of. It had overload or melt through her suit, and it looked tiny in a hand that'd cover a quarter of Iridian's shield if she let him, her, get that close. They'd been ambushed, and Iridian swore at herself under her breath for not having seen it coming. Sloane always seemed to be facing the right direction before trouble arrived, and the captain's smile looked more menacing than the bodyguard's serious frowns. Tritheist stepped toward them, but Captain Sloane stopped him with a hand on his chest plate. "What do you want, Rosehatch?" Rosehatch laughed, a rasping, delighted sound likely fueled by chems. It raked over Iridian's rapidly fraying nerves.
"I want you to get back on that taxi you rode in on and fly sunward until you light up," Rosehatch said. "But that doesn't seem likely, does it?"
"It does not," said Captain Sloane. "Your former position is no longer available, of course, but I could be persuaded not to have you fed into one of these machines if you have something else to offer."
"You do what I ask when I ask it. Show your face, take the jobs I say, skip the jobs I say. You won't have everything you want, but—"
Rosehatch's semi-professional demeanor dissolved into a vicious smile Iridian longed to put her fist through.
"Everyone will think you do, just like on Barbary. Oh, I heard your little announcements taking credit for this and that, but some of the Martians you left with tell a different tale."
There'd been too many Martian refugees stranded on Barbary Station to expect all of them to support Captain Sloane's fictitious claim of living in luxury there, especially after the ITA rescued and questioned them. Captain Sloane smiled with humorless eyes slightly narrowed, the way Adda's looked while she sorted through options. Adda herself was staring at her comp glove's readout on the back of her hand, which could mean anything. Her other hand gripped her strangely silent brother's wrist. They were unarmed, but that wouldn't stop a man like Rosehatch from having them killed where they stood.
"Your alternative," Rosehatch continued, "is to calmly, oh so calmly, deliver yourself into the benevolent hands of station security. The ITA will be fascinated to hear your statement. After Oxia's CEO has his say, of course."
Beside the captain, Tritheist's face twisted in fury and he panted against Sloane's hand, which, hidden from Rosehatch's sight by the angle of Sloane's body, was clenched on the edge of Tritheist's chest plate. Even Rosehatch's bodyguards were smirking. Somehow that was more than Iridian's held-in temper would tolerate. Barbary Station had been a nightmare. They'd come halfway across the solar system to what should have been Sloane's territory, where Adda and Pell should have been safe, and found this snickering, self-serving slime ball in charge. And now he was trying to get them arrested or enslaved. Both bodyguards tensed and focused on the palmer in her hand as she raised it. But by then she'd already fired once. When the charged particles struck the little one, her body jolted so hard that knives popped out of their sheaths. By the time the first blade bounced off the floor, Iridian had fired a second blast, and the big guard staggered and dropped like it had burst her, his, heart. 16. 17. The palmer snapped again. One of the flame-shaped implants in Rosehatch's forehead detonated, leaving a ragged wound that exposed several centimeters of splintered skull and launched him at the floor at an awful angle. 18. In the low grav, the bodyguards and two more of the little one's knives hit the floor after he did. The big one's face screwed up in fury and pain, and the armor buster twitched toward Iridian. She planted her boot on a wrist as thick around as her forearm, pressing the arm across the guard's chest to keep the weapon well away from the crew. The big bodyguard gagged and writhed to throw her off, but her armor and her balance kept her boot in place. The big bodyguard's eyes widened as they lost focus. The arm under Iridian's boot went limp, and the armor buster slid to the floor. The little bodyguard didn't grab for any of her knives. Something in the palmer was overheating. Its smoking electronics overpowered the odor of cooked flesh. Nobody'd designed a holster for the palmers, so she just held it away from her legs so it wouldn't scorch her armor. The crew stared at her, Captain Sloane with something like delight, the others just surprised. Tritheist raised his own palmer from his side without pointing it directly at her, ready in case she turned on him. Adda's eyes were the widest. Iridian had taken 18 lives over the course of her own, but this was the first time Adda had watched her do it. And, yeah, that required an explanation. The fight was coming no matter what. It was safer this way. Iridian glanced over her shoulder at Rosehatch. And we're not getting arrested for a wannabe like him. 10 or 12 much better armed and armored individuals stepped out from behind the nearest rock-crushing machine, weapons trained on Sloane's crew. The large barrels suggested low-penetration projectiles, the kind that'd fill an unruly crowd with a nerve-damaging nanomachine culture. Full armor would filter out the worst of it, but Adda and Pell would be fucked. In the new arrival center, projected above a small and expensive-looking stage drone that countered Vestin Grav with spinning rotors, stood an older man in spotless business attire. "Don't worry about Rosehatch." The projected man's smile was even oilier than the dead man's. "You'll find that others are willing to send you to prison." Chapter 3. Long-term docking permits created by unregistered admin, level account 3. On the back of Adda's hand, the words, "Should I engage?" could have looked incidental, unimportant. They scrolled by in a list of several other snippets from messages that had arrived in the past few hours. They were read because one of the universe's very few non-human intelligences sent them, and Adda wanted to know everything it said. And now it was asking her if it ought to attack people in a mine almost 2 kilometers below a city-sized space station, a mine that she, Iridian, and Pell were also standing in. Iridian covered as much of Pell and Adda with her shield as she could, leaving half her own torso exposed. The shield would block weapon fire from the front, but the newcomer had brought enough armed people to encircle them. The figure on the mobile projection stage, whose heavy-lidded eyes and skin slightly darker than Iridian's shivered slightly in the projector's light, was still talking to Captain Sloane. If Adda spent too long watching the situation develop before she accepted the Casey's offered help, it might be too late for even an awakened intelligence to save them. 2 armed people stepped forward and rolled Rosehatch's body onto its back. One placed a thick mask over the body's nose, mouth, and throat, ignoring the awful wound in the forehead. Another affixed a device to the side of the neck and cut open the dead man's shirt to press another device between the strangely protruding ribs of his chest. The second one slapped down on the chest device and Rosehatch's body convulsed. Both soldiers, she supposed they were, raised their weapons and stepped away while Rosehatch drifted a few centimeters off the floor and then collapsed onto it again. "Liu Kong, I presume?" Captain Sloane addressed one of the other armed people, focusing on a prominent cam lens on the man's helmet. "So Oxia Corporation has claimed Vesta from its core to its station space." Sloane lowered one of the bowl-shaped pirate weapons that the captain, Tritheist, and Iridian all carried. "It's an unusual approach." A sub-vocalized search and a glance at Ada's comp indicated that the man on the mobile projection stage was the head of the multiplanetary megacorporation that owned or contracted all of Vesta's mining, shipping, and infrastructure. She activated her comp's mic, muted its speaker, and opened a live audio connection to the KC. One of the armed people was watching her and shifted a weapon to cover Ada, so she must not have kept her lips as still as she had meant to. The woman didn't shoot her, so Ada finished her instructions to the KC in sub-vocalization to text. She didn't even need to put it in her messaging software since the KC seemed to be monitoring her comp activity. We may need help getting out of here. Please work up scenarios. Do not engage. Without a workspace or intermediary to translate her intentions to the KC, she had no guarantee that the message would be interpreted the way she wanted. Even if the KC understood her meaning, it'd still make its own decision about whether or not Adda needed rescuing. The usual approach would have been much less certain. The man Sloane had addressed as Liu Kong gave each syllable the same weight and stress. He frowned at Rosehatch and the dead bodyguards sprawled on the floor. Unusual approaches carry different risks. Which is why we're speaking now. Sloane's voice betrayed the captain's tension. Iridian's thick black eyebrows were drawn down and her shield was still raised. Apparently, there was still a good chance they'd all be shot or captured within the next few minutes. What, Adda wondered with equal parts eager curiosity and dread, might the KC do to save us? After a short pause, Liu Kong said, I still have work for your crew, and the power struggles playing out in your absence perpetuated by your supposed choice to remain on Barbary Station have wasted time. My time. A muscle in Sloane's jaw twitched. The captain's gaze flicked over the array of weapons aimed at them. Somehow, the way Captain Sloane stood straighter looked like an admission of defeat. I'll need to refresh myself on the crew's activities to date, but I expect our key personnel to be available for the job. Each word sounded heavy, as if the captain expended great effort to say that instead of something easier, depending on what is required. I don't need your services for the duration of a job, Liu Kong said over the captain's last few words. Either something was going wrong with their communications equipment, or Liu Kong was a very long way away from them. If that's all you're willing to offer, the ITA keeps a cell reserved for you. I'm sure we could make room for your crew. Captain Sloane's expression stayed formal and blank, but the rest of the crew looked as appalled as Adda felt. So their choices were to be turned over to the ITA, get killed on the spot, or sign a corporate contract binding the crew's services and everyone in it to Oxia. If they signed a mega corporate contract and then broke it, they'd be pariahs among major organizations, both legal and semi-legal, throughout populated space. The break would be on record. Any potential employer would learn about it, even the ones who didn't register their own agreements in the public databases. And although she had no intention of looking for employment outside Sloane's crew, she preferred to have an escape route that could keep her and Iridian together. The alternative was some megacorp contracting them separately in different parts of the solar system. Mega corporate contracts were an efficient means of losing decades of your life to make money for someone else. Adda and Iridian had hijacked a colony ship, fought a station's worth of AI-controlled robots, and traveled 250 million kilometers to avoid that fate. Pell had practically sold himself into slavery to avoid it. Gods only knew what Sloane and Tritheist had done. May I assume it's worth my time to continue, Captain Sloane? Liu Kong said. Sloane gritted. Proceed. Like the word itself was the signature. We may start with this, Liu Kong said. Are you familiar with the Rentronics PR-800i printer? Adda shook her head minutely and subvocalized the query to her comp while Iridian said, "Don't they print the organic and inorganic parts of pseudo-organic tech simultaneously?"
"Oh, that. I heard it prints people parts," said Pell, "like add-on bits and prosthetics that play nice with pseudo-organics."
He was serious about replacing his scarred eyes with pseudo-organic ones. He'd actually read about how they were made. Adda was impressed. Captain Sloane raised an eyebrow at him, then turned back to Leo Kong. "They're massively expensive. Outside your budget, I presume?" Leo Kong's face twisted with disgust for a moment, then returned to the bland superiority he'd been addressing them with so far. "Ingobe Marvin Minerals just equipped their new Kuiper long hauler with one that would suit our needs. Its flyby refueling from Ceres is scheduled for next week."
"A long hauler?" Tritheist huffed a disgusted laugh. "Those lock up like a doomsday vault."
Adda really needed to finish the software package for the implanted throat mic she and Iridian were working on. That would have let her share the information directly, but now she had to speak. While Sloane, Tritheist, and Iridian exchanged meaningful glances, Adda asked, "How much will you pay up front?" Gods, she hated it when she said something that made people stare at her. Maybe the rest of the crew was still deciding whether they should work on the problem, but Adda could either search for a solution or weep, and tears were just biological procrastination. Sometimes the fastest way to get more information was to walk people through the obvious details until they gave her the rest to shut her up. Infiltrating the long hauler is all about timing, correct? The target ship's going a long way on a very specific route. Where we intercept the ship to steal the printer will depend on how much fuel we'll have to get there and back, and that depends on our funds before we leave. One of the large diameter pipes overhead shook as a controlled avalanche of small rocks rattled toward Vesta's surface. Sloane's face was a confusing mask of chagrin and what might have been admiration. "My operations strategist, Adda Karpe," the captain explained to Leo Kong once the noise level decreased again. It was a good title, even if this was the first time she'd heard it. "If the task is at all feasible, we can, of course, discuss terms at a later date." Leo Kong gestured from the man physically standing in front of them with the cam lens toward Adda. The lens focused on her. The projected CEO was looking at her the way he might have observed a particularly clever spider before he crushed it. "It will have to be feasible, Captain. You assembled a talented group of unscrupulous persons on this jet. I would prefer to retain your name recognition and well-documented successes, but someone else could be found. Someone with a comprehensive grasp of feasibility." He smiled at Adda. Curse all the luck of ages. Why did people keep acting like she wanted to lead Sloane's crew? She shifted her weight toward Iridian's comforting presence. All she'd ever wanted was to solve interesting problems, mostly with AI. She had no interest in solving problems about people or worse, megacorporations. "That won't be necessary." Captain Sloane's expression definitely conveyed annoyance now, some of which was directed at Adda. "I accept. Please send me the details along with whatever Rosehatch knew that was necessary to the endeavor, since he's no longer available to ask."
"Oh, I think he'll manage an answer or two," said Leo Kong. "I have other questions to ask him."
"But," Pell gulped audibly, "he's dead, isn't he?"
Leo Kong turned his projection stage robot and hovered unhurriedly through the path his enforcers made for it. After a meter of stately retreat, he said, "Death is rarely so instantaneous," and his projected figure disappeared from the mobile stage. The man with the cam on his helmet said, "Bring Rosehatch, clean up the rest." Iridian frowned at the enforcers who shoved the bodyguard's corpses aside to make room for an inflating stretcher for Rosehatch. "Can you save her too?" she asked one of the soldiers preparing Rosehatch's body to be moved. The man glanced at the knife-wielding bodyguard sliding down the sloping floor deeper into the mine and shrugged.
10 minutes ago, maybe. Now she's meat and H2O.
Iridian's swearing just made him smile nastily and return to his work.
Back up and go, said the man wearing Liu Kong's cam on his helmet.
Captain Sloane turned on a booted heel, coat flowing dramatically in the low gravity.
Move out, Tritheist ordered on the captain's behalf.
Adda hooked an arm through Pell's to lead him away without stepping on any bodies. Iridian kept her shield between them and the Oxia guns.
So, Pell said as soon as the Casey's exterior pass-through door closed behind Iridian, when do we run and where are we going?
Where, indeed, Sloane chuckled, a hollow, bitter sound. The captain sank into the pilot's seat, slowly, to account for Vesta's surface gravity. A tiny plastic alignment tool which had escaped Iridian's set during their arrival skittered across the cabin in front of Tritheist's boot as he joined Sloane at the console. I haven't been to headquarters in 2 years, Sloane said. I'm dying to see how the place has kept in my absence.
The word dying carried more emphasis than Adda would have put on it. The majority of Sloane's resources would be under Oxia Corporation's control now, but the crew had worked with almost nothing before. There had to be somewhere less dangerous to base their operations. Sloane hadn't legally committed to anything yet, but the captain's mind sounded made up.
Why are we staying?
We're what? Pell gripped Adda's arm as the Casey sailed out of the mine's loading dock. Gravity pulled people and clutter sideways for a second before it oriented toward the floor.
We're staying, Sloane said slowly, because when I left Vesta, Rhea Sylvia Station was ours, and Albana Station was as good as. Why else would I have spent so much effort convincing the station councils that I remained on Barbary by choice, poor choice though it would have been? And since we are not in a position to storm Oxia's main campus, first because it is nowhere near here, and second because I'm not sure of my crew's complement at the moment, I will be playing the role of Oxia's minion while engineering an opportunity to regain my position here.
So the Vestan Station Councils are a joke? Iridian looked horrified.
Adda didn't have a problem with the station's two governing bodies doing as little as possible, which seemed to be the case with Rhea Sylvia Station's 12-member council and Albana Station's 8-member one. Governments with too much power started wars.
Who coordinates infrastructure safety? Iridian asked.
Station councils pick somebody. In the past, the crews kept watch on them, said Captain Sloane. A practice I intend to continue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.